I You may be seated. On behalf of the Boberg family, I want to express my appreciation for your attendance here, but even more than that, over the last few days, for every kind word, for every gesture of goodwill, for every kind act, for every prayer, for every dish that you prepared. The family wishes to say how much they appreciate it and how loving and kind of people that you are. Thank you very much. They've asked me to read a song from the Old Testament, the book of Psalms, the very last one, in fact, Psalm 150, where the psalmist wrote, "Praise the Lord, praise God in his sanctuary, praise him in his mighty heavens, praise him for his acts of power, praise him for his surpassing greatness, praise him with the sounding of the trumpet, praise him with the harp and the lyre, praise him with timbrel and dancing. Praise him with the strings and pipe. Praise him with the clash of cymbals. Praise him with resounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord." Oh, praise the Lord. May we pray together, please. On this day, Lord, we do indeed come into this sacred room praising you. It is a day when we both mourn and celebrate the homegoing of a Christian wife, mother, sister, friend. And we offer our thanks for her life. We thank you for your being with us in all that we undertake. We thank you for coming to us in the mortal flesh of Jesus of Nazareth, and through him giving us the promise of life beyond death. Lord, for a faith shared in both sorrow and joy, we give you thanks and offer this prayer in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. One of Jane's favorite hymns, and one that we will sing together now, is hymn 310, "Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee." May we please stand as we sing together.
Yeah. Thank you. You may be seated.
For 10 years, Jane served as the organist choirmaster at St. Peter Evangelical Lutheran Church in Southport. And when she left there, it was a very fitting tribute to her that they had a piece commissioned in her honor. The words and music by a very well-known composer named Pepper Choplin. And so the choir and the C-note participants will now perform. It's called Fly On, Sweet Heavenly Dove. The 13th chapter of 1 Corinthians is often called the love chapter. The family has requested that this be read during this time. And so the Apostle Paul wrote, "If I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all that I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It doesn't envy. It doesn't boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. But where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when completeness comes, what in part disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child, thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put the ways of childhood behind me. For now we see only a reflection, as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love." May we pray together. Eternal and loving God, you are the giver of life, and we thank you for all the stages of our life, from birth to death and beyond death. We praise you for the freshness, the innocence, the wide-eyed curiosity of childhood. We thank you for the wildly exciting trials of adolescence, for youthful dreams and touching awkwardness. We praise you for all the right choices we made in our early maturity, and yet we beg your forgiveness for making so many wrong ones. We thank you for the satisfaction of our later maturity, for teaching us, sometimes painfully, how to give more and expect less in return. And we praise you for as many sunset years as you may have in store for us, for fragments of wisdom, for grandchildren, and for the courage to face our mortality strengthened by the promise of a more perfect life, thanks to the love and the willing sacrifice of your blessed Son. Thank you, Father, for the life of your child, Jane Boberg, ended here and resumed with the Lord. Amen. At this time, Paul Robinson, who is the vice president of the C-Notes, has a few words of appreciation.
Good afternoon. On behalf of the C-Notes, I would like to express our sincere condolences to George and all of the Boberg family for the devastating loss of our beloved Jane. Her wonderful talents as an organist, pianist, and director were a blessing to all of the C-Notes family, who had the joy of knowing and working with her over these many years. Jane's endless patience with repeating parts over and over again to make sure we got it right. Her never-ending smile during our rehearsals made learning our music and being part of something larger than ourselves a wonderful experience. Her contributions to our organization are an awesome legacy. Jane directed, excuse me, C-Notes concert. She accompanied the C-Notes for 31 different concerts, totaling 72 performances, in all the weeks of rehearsals before each concert. No words can say how much we will miss her in the coming months and years. God bless you, Jane. God bless your family and all your friends who mourn their loss and losing a light in their lives. We have faith that you are in a better place with a piano that's always in tune. With prayers and love, thank you. God bless you, George, and all your family.
Our program says that there are some words of remembrance from Susan Gregg, and there are. There are some things that have been written here by her family that they have asked me to read. The first one is from Bradley Gregg. It says, "I am Bradley Gregg, Jane Boberg's youngest nephew. I wish to honor my aunt by sharing my perspective as a child growing up to highlight some aspects of her character. These aspects of character are broad, corporate, and loving. I will first share about how she was broad, which allowed her to share her playfulness, fun, and liveliness with others. A broad person can have fun with all different kinds of people. Aunt Jane loved playing board games where she would be very lively. We would laugh till the tears came, playing them with her and Uncle George. She knew how to have fun on vacations. At Lakeside, she would teach us to play shuffleboard and sing many neat songs that she and my mother sang as children. Another character trait of my aunt was that she was corporate. A corporate person will let others participate in what they are doing so they can enjoy it too. She often bought me a very special cream stick donut from a park market every time she visited, and she usually bought a bag of candy to share with my brothers and me. She loved music and loved encouraging us to be creative and love music too. For example, she gave me two kits for build-it-yourself instruments, an African xylophone and an ocarina whistle, which I painted. In addition, she gave me books and art supplies to inspire my intellectual curiosity. My Aunt Jane was a loving person who cared very much for me growing up. When my grandmother died, she and my mother are the ones who informed my brothers and me as we approached the hospital. Her being there with my mom helped me as a child to understand what was happening in a gentle way. She took the time to meet my needs as a young person, and she was caring in that she would help to make me and my brothers' lives comfortable and fun. She often had a special gift or game to show my brothers and me when she visited to make our time together special and exciting. She always hugged and kissed me when she came and before saying goodbye when she left. As my wife and I are expecting our third child any day now, I aspire to honor my family by showing virtues such as those of my Aunt Jane." That was from Bradley Gregg, who could not be here because he and his wife are expecting their third child at any time. Brian Gregg, his brother, wrote this, "It is with awe and inspiration that I reflect on what Aunt Jane has meant to Ben, Bradley, and me as her three nephews in Ohio. Make no mistake, above all, there never was a greater aunt. Just to say it out loud, Aunt Jane, it rolls off the tongue and always will. She was a natural. It's only right, though, to enumerate all the other things that Aunt Jane was to us beyond the world's best aunt. Five things jump to mind. She was the ultimate family beacon, serving as the true matriarch of our Lorenz, Boberg, Gregg family crew, role modeling to all of us what it really means to live family first. She was the consummate host. Any conversation with Jane usually ended with an invitation to North Carolina and a walk on the beach. No matter what. Even in hurricane season, her casa was your casa. She was the most authentic gift giver that ever did give. From the gift tag to the gift contents, it was always uniquely Jane. In fact, the best part of all Aunt Jane's gifts was hearing her tell the elaborate story of where she found the gift, why it made her think of you, and how it was the most perfect thing in the world. And 9 times out of 10, she had purchased one for herself, too. She was the world's most entertaining game player, whether it was Risk, Sorry, Uno, or Monopoly. If Aunt Jane was playing, you were going to have a blast, period. From her contagious laughter to her screams of delight and despair, the whole neighborhood knew when Aunt Jane was playing a game of euchre. And geez, was it always fun. And finally, she was the most extraordinary example of how to live life. To truly know what it is that makes you happy and give every minute of your life to that. Her church, her music, her commitment to friends, her utter love for the beach, and yes, her life partnership with George. She was always all in. In fact, she didn't eat butter with self-doubt or promises to reduce future consumption. Oh no, she ate butter like she did everything in life with confidence, pride, and complete commitment. Aunt Jane, we will all miss you dearly. Thank you for being everything that you were, a true inspiration to me, my family, and everyone you touched. And finally, there are words from Sue Gregg. It's a poem. It's entitled, My Sister, What Can I Say About My Quirky, Wonderful Sister? These two must have been a musical force in Ashland, Ohio, as they were coming to maturity. I've looked up to my sister all of my life. She was the older, wiser one. I was a tag-along sprite. She played the piano so beautifully, I just wanted to play it similarly. But she was always getting into trouble with our mom and dad. I learned what not to do by watching her and was very glad. She made so many excuses, practicing the piano to avoid trips to the bathroom, and phone calls were some of her favorites, and our dad was definitely annoyed. She was the gregarious, outgoing one. I was shy and more reserved, so I think she had more fun. She always had a perpetual tan, and I burned and peeled like no one else can. She taught music to children with so much passion, I even copycatted her career after a fashion. We went to music workshops together and shopped for clothes in any kind of weather. We bought knickknacks we just had to have and phoned many times a day just so we could gab. I was always there for her and she was always there for me. After all, we sat on the same branch of the Lorenz family tree. I love you and miss you, my dearest sister Jane. Nothing in my life will ever be quite the same. I know you're up there accompanying a great heavenly chorus like the choir today that has honored you so beautifully for us. Just one last request no one from me can ever wrench. Just save me a place on that heavenly piano bench. Thank you, Greg, Bradley, and certainly Susan for these wonderful words. We're all going to worship together as we sing now one of the truly great hymns of faith, number 48, Great is Thy Faithfulness. May we stand as we sing together. seated. Shortly after Jesus and his disciples had their final meal, their last supper, Jesus began to talk to them and tell them about what was to come. It's usually referred to as the final discourse of the disciples from the 14th through the 17th chapters of John's Gospel. In the 14th chapter, beginning with verse 1, very familiar passage, that says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me so that you may also be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going." But Thomas said, "Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way?" And Jesus answered, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." And then from Paul's letter to the Roman church, he wrote from the 8th chapter, "Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble, hardship, persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword? No. In all of these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. It has been said by more than one person that music was Jane's life, and there is ample evidence to give credence to that assertion. She taught music in the public schools for 32 years. She served as a church musician nearly all of her life from the time that she was in high school. And she participated in community endeavors, musical endeavors, nearly all of her adult life. Music was indeed Jane's life. And she was a consummate professional. If there were 100 notes in a two-measure passage, all 100 had to be played. Playing 99 of them would render the passage incomplete and therefore incorrect. It was that musical integrity that made her a fabulous keyboard artist. And she found, and in turn she gave, such delight in music over the course of so many years. But I don't think one can separate the memory of Jane's love for music with the memory of her love for God. Her music issued from her faith. It was nothing less than the harmony of her heart in union with the will of God for her life. That's what made Jane special. She was first and foremost devoted to God and to his church. And because of her devotion, her music had the quality of dedication and faith. Faithfully, week by week, she sat here at this piano, almost hidden from sight, as she coaxed such beautiful music from this instrument. Often, those of us who stand in front of the microphone are the ones who receive the accolades, but there are so many others like Jane, who indispensably give their gifts. There was an article that I read several years ago by a late church historian, taught at Yale University. His name was Kenneth LaTourette. He wrote a sweeping 7-volume history of the 2,000-year expansion of Christianity, but LaTourette observed that the real history of the church didn't have so much to do with popes and bishops and preachers as it had to do with those persons who came early to the little country churches on winter mornings to build the fires so that the worshipers would be comfortable, or with the woman who uses her God-given talent to sing and play at funerals and bring comfort to the mourners. Dr. LaTourette said that these latter persons are the real makers of church history, not the popes, not the bishops, not the preachers, but their names often are not recorded for posterity, but you can be sure that Jane's name is recorded in our hearts for all of her contributions to our church history. In Psalm 92, God's Word, we find it written, The righteous will flourish like a palm tree. They will bear fruit in old age. They will stay fresh and green, proclaiming, "The Lord is my rock." Those words sound as if they were written by a seasoned saint, one who knows the challenges of life and also the power of God's salvation. Although it's easy to overlook, there is a promise locked away in the words of this psalm, a promise that's been copied and rearranged in 1,000 different hymns throughout the ages, a promise that will last beyond the shadows of time and into eternity, a promise embraced by Jane and now is embracing her. The psalmist writes, "The righteous will stay fresh and green." I think Jane would encourage us to live lives harmonious to that hope. She would encourage us to follow her example, as her nephews have said, to live every day to its fullest, on good days and on bad days, and to do so for the sake of Christ and not for our own gain. I believe that she would encourage us to teach this song of faith to others, those who don't know the tune or don't know the lyrics, and to join with us in this choir of faith that we call the church. Which is why I believe that Jane's life was nothing less than music to God's ears. Whenever God turned his ear to Jane, I'm certain he heard a heart that was faithful and a soul wrapped in a song of praise to his name. It's not far-fetched to say that Jane's whole life was a living psalm, a note of praise here, a short lament there, no doubt an occasional complaint, but always with an underlying rhythm of thanksgiving. All of Jane's existence, her years growing up, her playing the piano in so many schoolrooms, her playing the piano and organ at so many church services, all of her frustrations and delights, all of her troubles and her joys, the entirety of Jane's existence was a rehearsal, a preparation for her part in that unending life, that in unending music to which she was called last Monday morning. The same holds true for us, of course. The things we do, the music we make, the succession of our days, our months, and our years together constitute one vast rehearsal, preparation for a larger life and for a music that will never end. But this realization brings us face to face with the paradox. On the one hand, everything we do is terribly important because it contributes to this rehearsal for eternal life, an eternal song. Nothing is insignificant, not a single thought or word or action. Whatever we do is very important. And yet, whatever we do, how significant it may be, falls short of ultimate and final importance. What we do here is simply a rehearsal, marked as rehearsals always are by imperfection, uncertainty, incompleteness. Our lives are a series of beautiful music and missed notes, irregular rhythms, smooth passages, and sometimes challenging dissonances that are eventually resolved into perfect harmony sanctioned by our Lord. The music we make now finds its fulfillment only in the eternal music of that shining city to which each of us is called. But in life, as in music, a mistake or an interruption, as troubling or even as heartbreaking as it may be, can actually turn out to provide an opportunity to create an altogether new sound. There's a story about Wynton Marsalis that I want to tell you about. Marsalis is one of the truly great jazz trumpeters in the world. During a performance of a small jazz club in New York, Marsalis was playing a particularly soulful tune and playing it beautifully. Right in the middle of it, a cell phone of someone in the audience started plinking out a little ditty, effectively destroying the mood of that piece. Now, everyone knows that musicians have the reputations of being, shall I say, temperamental. And no one would have been surprised if Marsalis had stormed off the stage in protest. But that's not what happened. Instead, Marsalis started playing the melody of that phone ringtone, and then he did a variation on it, incorporating the tune that he had planned. And finally, he pulled that improvised piece back to the original ballad theme. Well, as you can imagine, the house went absolutely wild. Wynton Marsalis had taken what was generally seen as a rude interruption of what was expected and turned it into a stunningly creative work of art. There's a parallel between that story and the reason for our assembly on this day. In Jane's death, we have experienced a rude interruption of life. That shrill, dissonant clang of death seems to have silenced the music and the melody of life. Sometimes feels that we'll never be able to know the harmony and the lyrics of a full life again. But on this day, we do well to remember that it is God that is standing on that conductor's podium. He is the composer of the music, and he is the master of the variations. We gather today in thankful praise that because of the victory of Jesus Christ over death itself, God can take the cacophony of death and turn it into joyful, everlasting life. Music was Jane's life. It's also true that Jane's life and ours is a kind of music. To be sure, our lives are music in rehearsal. It's music that won't last. However, it does prepare us for that final and eternal symphony is greater than we can even imagine. And as God's people, we will one day join Jane in a stirring chorus of hallelujahs that will put even Handel's best efforts to shame. Amen and amen.
Good afternoon. My name is Marie-Pierre Fletcher, and I am the choir director, as you already noticed before. I was not only lucky enough to make music with Jane here at the chapel and with the C notes. We are friends. I don't need to tell you again what a great musician and special person she was. We heard that. And my tribute to Jane today will be one of her favorite pieces, You Raise Me Up. But I just wanted to share this with you. From time to time, when I had a cold or I wasn't feeling that well, Jane called to check on me and to tell me to relax and to take good care of myself. She insisted that she had the right to tell me so. As my mom already passed away years ago, she considered herself as my American mom, and she told me, you have to do what your mom says. I have news for you, Jeff. I am your American sister. As Irving Berlin said, the song has ended, but the melody lingers on. Stand on my no life without its hunger. Each restless heart beats so imperfectly. But when you come and I am filled with wonder, sometimes I think I glimpse eternity. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me to more than I can be.
I charge you now to remember that God has promised to bless and to keep us in this life and in our new life with the Lord. The same God whose face now shines on our beloved Jane has promised through our Lord to forgive us and to shelter us throughout history. I charge you to find your comfort and peace in these gracious promises of a loving God. And now I would offer to you the great Aaronic blessing given to God's people so many centuries ago, and that is, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Thank you.
service, huh? Our sister home church needed something awesome, man.
It's been like a typical thing. Thanks.
Thank you.